with me about ministering to your faith. Amen. And so we started doing what we believe the Lord wanted us to do, and we're going to continue in that vein. Amen. Amen. You know, faith is a subject matter that we all always want to hear. Amen. Especially so that you can make sure that you're continually, and that word continue is a necessary word. Amen. As it relates especially to this subject matter, continuing to operate in the principles that foster faith. You got it? Amen. Continue to operate in the principles that foster faith or keeps your faith strong. You got it? And it's an ongoing process. Is that you, Brittany? That's Brittany. Praise the Lord. We was watching television the other night, me and Sister Kaiser, and it was a little girl on there. I said, that looked like a young Brittany, don't it? And there she is, and trying to sneak up on me. Amen. But the Lord showed her to me on TV. Ain't that a blessing? Glad to see you, Brittany. Amen. But you want to make sure that you continue to operate in the principles that sustains your faith. You got it? Some years ago, I told y'all about that there's faith to obtain, and then there's faith to maintain. You got it? And you need faith for both of those categories, to obtain what you believe God has said is yours and to maintain what you believe God has said. Even where your salvation is concerned, you have to maintain your faith and keep it engaged where your salvation is concerned. How many of y'all believe that?
Amen.
Amen. You have to do that, amen, because, see, you can go back on God if you want to. Hello? I say, if you want to, amen, you can go back on God, amen, and God will honor the authority of your will to do so, and he'll allow you to do that, amen, and so we don't want to ever do that, though. Amen. He won't leave you, but you can leave him if you choose to. Amen, amen. And so you want to keep your faith alive in every area, but especially, amen, about your salvation. And there are principles that we have to function in order for that to happen, because it just don't just happen, right? Amen. You can get up, you know, day by day and not do anything that feeds your faith, and you'll find yourself in a situation where your faith will seem as if it's weak. Amen. And a lot of times people, you know, they hadn't done what they're supposed to do, and then they wind up getting mad with God, you know, because faith ain't working against those things that no more that didn't frustrate you, you know, little manifestations that the adversary come up with, that when your faith is engaged properly, man, you can kick that to the curb, right? Amen. Amen. But if you're not doing what you're supposed to do, them same little bitty things, the little leaven, you know, will start getting on your nerve. Y'all got it? Amen. And that's really not God's fault, and it's not anybody else's fault, right? Because God has given to every man, hallelujah, Jesus, amen, the measure of faith. And what that means is that every man, and that means, you know, mankind, mean woman also, is responsible for the maintenance of their faith, right? My faith is my faith, and I'm responsible for the maintenance on that faith. You got it? Amen. So look at your neighbor, say, neighbor,
pastor
is not
responsible
for your maintenance. Y'all got, you're not responsible for your maintenance. You have to do your own maintenance. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, if you need a tune-up, say it. Tell your neighbor. You need to keep coming to church. Now, pastor, do tune-ups. Y'all got it. He do tune up. That's right. That's right. You need service, go to the service. I like that. He do tune ups. Amen. But you responsible for how you drive your faith when you leave here. Amen. You can't be waiting till you all get all dirty and and everything. Praise the Lord. Y'all got it? All them cars come with a manual. You're right. And they tell you how often you need to change the oil. Amen. And get a service done on it. And I like to encourage you, some of you, you know, Sister Kyle's expedition, you know, it's not quite time to get the oil changed yet, a couple hundred miles away. You know, and I was riding it yesterday. And the Lord said, well, why do you have to wait till it needs it? Yeah, why? And some people wait till they need it. You got it. So just go on, take the thing. You ain't but a couple hundred miles away. Take it on in. Let them do a service on it. Y'all follow me and keep the thing going good. Amen. Y'all all right with that? All right. Habakkuk. Lord have mercy. Car analogy. Y'all know some cars you can't take to a shade tree, don't you? I'm just telling you now. You, amen. If you got a nice vehicle, you might as well quit being cheap and go on take that thing to the manufacturer. Y'all got it? Amen. And let folks who know what they're doing work on it. Then pay them for what they know. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's right. At least you can take it back to them, you know. But when you got Joe's shade tree, you know, you ain't nothing. You can't sue him. You can't hardly find him. You call him, he see your number. He know he done messed up. He ain't want to talk to you. Praise the Lord. So let's go on back to the manufacturer, right? The book of Habakkuk. The second chapter, let's try to move on from that. Verse 1, it says, I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I'm reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, right? But at the end it shall speak. You know, and not lie. Said, though it tarry, amen, do what?
Wait
for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry.
Amen.
Verse 4 says, behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall do what? Live by his faith. Amen. And so we started talking to you on Tuesday about living by faith, or more preferably, living by your faith. Amen. Because you are the just, right? You've been justified in Christ Jesus, and God has given you what it takes to live by. You got it? He's given us all what it takes, amen, to live by. The scripture says God has given us all things that pertain unto life, amen, and godliness. Amen. And so we as believers, there is no out for us. You know, the faith life is our life.
Amen.
You got it? I said the faith life is our life.
Amen.
And you don't have to, you know, get all bent out of shape about that, because if you develop your faith and keep it enhanced like you're supposed to, man, it's a sweet life. It's a worry-free life. You got worry-free, Pastor. Whenever you get in faith, you stop worrying. Y'all got it? Amen. And if you're still worrying, it may be an indication. You got it, that you may not be where you're supposed to be for that particular situation or circumstance. It got nothing to do with you not just saved and all that. But if the enemy trying to press you into fear and into worry, amen, you may need to, you know, get a tune-up. Amen. Because the faith life is a stress-free life. It's a fear-free life. Amen? And I understand the learning curve and the development and all of that type of thing. You know, all that's encompassed in that. So we're not ministering condemnation. You got it? Amen. But sometimes I think Paul told Timothy, you know, sometimes you have to pray for those to recover themselves out of the snare of the enemy. And sometimes those that are in the snare of the enemy have to pray that they recover themselves out of the snare, right? Listen, I've been in a snare of fear before. Amen. Y'all got it. Been in a snare of worry before. Y'all got it. Amen. But I had to do exactly what I'm telling you. You got to do. I had to recover myself from that place. You got it, because it was not going to produce the result that I wanted. You got it? Amen. And so, you know, our life is a life of faith, right? And we're going to get there. We're going to do our best to stay there so we can be at peace while God is working all these things out that he's given an appointed time to be manifested. Y'all got it? Amen. And so, praise the Lord. I think Sister Cosby might have been ministering some years ago about something, and she said the Lord told her, said that, now listen, you're going to get through this, but how you look when you come out is up to you. Right? Amen. Amen. How you look when you come out is up to you. And I believe it's the will of God, for if you have gone through that, when you come out, and I even believe while you're going, God don't want you to look like it. Don't be looking like it. Y'all, you know, some people are highly adept at looking pitiful. Woo! Y'all praying. Amen. Highly adapted. Amen. And looking pitiful. Amen. And that ain't how you want to live. Y'all got it? Amen. Because the truth is, folk run from folk like that. They don't. Dumb. Right? Amen. And so I would rather for you to, you know, square your shoulders. Amen. Hold your head up. Walk up and say, you know, don't do this today now. And say, Pastor, you know, I'm just in need. I'm trusting God. But if you can, yeah, do that. Don't be doing that. Amen. You would rather that happen, wouldn't you? Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. See, because that, see, when they do that, they don't, it don't make you feel bad to say no if the Lord tells you to say no.
Okay, God.
All right. That was too much. So the just shall live, what?
By his
and his is a personal pronoun, right?
Yeah.
That means your specific faith. And that does not mean that there aren't times when we set ourselves in agreement with you. Amen. And to help you stand. Right? Amen. And we're willing to do that as well. Amen. But we want to make sure that you ain't throwed in the towel. Amen. And you're not involved in the process of your deliverance with your own personal faith. Amen. You got something left. The enemy might try to make you think ain't nothing left, but you got something left. You still say, ask your neighbor, you still say? That means you got something left. Now tell them, use what you got. Hallelujah. Amen. Y'all are that's straight, isn't it? Amen. And so listen, just a little review and we will move on. The prophet Habakkuk was in pursuit, some background, of God wanting to know when God was going to judge the wickedness that his people were involved in. And thank God we're in grace, right? Thank you, Jesus. But the people of God had gotten so bad off until it had grieved the prophet's heart. It had grieved him. Amen. It grieved him to the point to where he wanted to know, God, when you going to do something about him? Are y'all all right? Amen. And in verse 5, he talked about the coming judgment on those who would continue in unrighteousness. But in verse 4 of the second chapter, he lets the prophet know that for those who would operate justly, their faith would produce a different outcome for them. Amen. And that's how it always is. Those that are getting faith, amen, recover yourself from the snare of the enemy. Your faith will produce a different outcome. Amen. He declared that the just would live or experience life and not death by using their faith. Amen. Amen. The just would live or experience life and not death by using their faith. And that life and death is not necessarily altogether talking about a demise of your physical existence, but it's talking about experiencing life in this life. You got it? Experiencing life in this life. How many of y'all know what I'm talking about? Amen. Your needs are being met and over and above and beyond You got it, amen, the abundant life that Jesus talked about in St. John 10 and 10. And so I'm not only just, you know, believing God to live long and strong from a physical aspect, but I'm also believing God to experience all that the good that life is supposed to bring into my life. Amen. Y'all got it because I'm in the kingdom. You got it? Amen. So you there also, right?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. The just shall live by faith. This word faith in this scripture is a Hebrew verb that means to believe or to trust in someone or something. And of course, a verb is defined as any class of words that express actions or the existence of something. So this definition, as it relates to the word faith, means that there must be an existence of something that carries with it a consistent action that makes faith a true reality in the life of the one who is operating in it. Amen? So we want faith to be a true reality, right? We want it to be a true reality. I told you on Tuesday that the word faith occurs 247 times in the Bible, two times in the Old Testament, in Deuteronomy 32 and 20, and in our foundational scripture of Habakkuk 2 and 4. And I found that real interesting, especially because of all of the manifestations that faith wrought in the Old Testament. You can only see the word actually two times in the Old Testament. You got it? Amen. And so I guess, you know, if I could get just a little common with you, it's best to have a good game than to talk a good game. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Amen. Some people talk a good game, but when it's time to get in the game, y'all, they're not producing. Right? See, and so, you know, you can't just talk faith. Man, you got to live faith. Right? Anybody can talk faith. Ain't ministering no condemnation. You follow me? But we don't want to fool ourselves. You got it? Amen. And so we don't want to talk a good game. Amen. We want to live this thing. Amen. Is that all right with you? Okay. In the New Testament, it occurs 245 times, beginning in the book of Matthew, the 6th chapter, verse 30, spoken of by Jesus, where Jesus declared, "O ye of little faith." Amen. O ye of little faith. And simply because they were concerned about what they were going to eat, where they were going to wear, you know, whether or not they was going to have a roof over their heads. And Jesus said, man, it takes little than little faith just to produce that. Amen. If I can say that like that. He said, O ye of little faith. Now, we got that in the reverse, right? Man, we got some of the most important things on our list of living is to have some need, have some clothes on our back, right, and have somewhere to stay, right? Well, Jesus said, that's a given. Jesus said, those are the things that you should not even be worrying about. Y'all got it? Let me show you how we really shouldn't be worried about it. He provide that for sinners. He provide that for people who are not even saved. He provide food, clothing, and shelter. And so he was kind of indignant. I dare you be concerned about those things when I'll do it for the sinner. Y'all got, it's more sinners with clothes and houses and food than there are without. You got, I'm not saying there's not people out there that are in need, and we should be the agents by which, you know, as the Lord lead, that those needs are met, not the government. You know, one of the, oh God, don't go down, go down. Amen. When the church some years ago abdicated their responsibilities as it relates to the poor and we turned it over to the government, that was the worst thing we could have done. Amen. You got it? Because, see, what we do is we teach people how to fish, not just give them a fish. Amen. And the government really don't want you to learn how to fish the way that you need to learn how to fish. That's exactly right. Amen. And so, but he said that in St. John 6 and 30, oh, you little faith, saying that we should not be worried about those things. Amen. Like that, because he got that. It's a given. He going to take care of you. He going to clothe you. He going to feed you. You got, he going to make sure you got housing. Is that all right? Amen. And so we can, in other words, we can be using our faith for something else. And the last place where it was mentioned was in the book of Revelation, the 14th chapter, verse 12, spoken of by the Apostle John concerning the faith of Jesus. John declared, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ," right? Now, what is the commandment of God? Somebody said it, right? What is the commandment of God? Love God with all of thy heart, soul, and might, right? And to love one another as you love yourself. So when you start talking about the commandments of God, don't go running back up under the law and trying to come up with 611 commandments. That's not what he's talking about. We're up under the raw commandment of love. You got it? See, if you love a person, you won't do nothing to harm that person. You won't steal from that person. You won't kill that person. You won't commit adultery. You won't commit fun. Y'all, if you love that person, you got it. Amen. And so love, amen, is the raw commandment that we are up under. Amen. So John declared, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ." Hebrews 12:2 says, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith." And so in the context of this teaching, this word author is defined as the originator or the creator of a thing. This word originator comes from the word origin, which is defined as the beginning, the source, the root, or the birthplace of a thing, right? In Revelations 1:8, Jesus declared, "I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending." Now listen, as an author, also it can be defined as someone who writes books. And in most cases, they write with a certain level of authority on a particular subject because they write with a certain level of personal revelation, research, and experience. Amen. Personal revelation, research, amen, and experience. Amen. There's a tremendous amount of revelation, research, and experience in this book. Amen. Tremendous amount. Amen. All right, a little bit. Praise the Lord. Y'all all right? So metaphorically speaking, Jesus wrote the book on the subject of faith. Since he is the author, amen, and the finisher of our faith, amen, he wrote the book, amen, on the subject, amen, of faith. Amen. He has perfect knowledge on the subject. He is the perfect example that we should follow. And the reason why that's so important is because a lot of times we miss it in our faith walk when we look to an imperfect man or woman as our greatest example of faith. Instead of looking unto the perfect Christ, y'all got it? Jesus Christ, amen, is the perfect example of faith. Y'all got it? He is the perfect man. He is the author of the subject. Y'all got it? Amen. Can't you imagine that perhaps, I mean, now you can receive this if you want, if you don't have to, you don't, but it kind of almost makes sense to me. Can't you imagine that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost having a corporate meeting about how mankind was going to be delivered? How they were going to get us back into right relationship with God. Huh? Are y'all all right with that? Amen. And one of the three, let's say Jesus came up with this idea. I'll tell you what, Father. What we're going to do, we're going to deposit in every man a measure of faith. And they would just, if they would just learn how to use their faith, everything that was lost can be regained. Oh, y'all don't want it. Everything that was lost can be regained if they would just use their faith. And Jesus said, and what I'll do, I know there's a penalty that has to be paid for the violation of your law. Don't eat. He said, I'm even willing to pay that penalty if they would just operate in this thing called faith. Are y'all hear what I'm saying? Won't nothing else be necessary? Glory to God. No other work will be necessary if they would just learn how to function and operate in this faith thing. They can get everything back that was lost. I thought that was pretty good right there. Are y'all all right? So he is the perfect example of faith. And one of his primary responsibilities, along with dying for our sins, was to give us a clear picture of what it means to walk and to live by faith. Y'all got that? Amen. So we want to always look to Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. Does not mean that I should not have be able to have confidence in Ella Coleman or Ella Sister Coleman Burrell or my wife or anybody. Yeah, but ultimately, Jesus is the author and the finisher of my faith. Because when you put in man what only belongs to God, you're going to always be disappointed. Y'all got, and that's in any of us. You follow me? You might confine one thing you're disappointed in me about, but that's all right. I'm just telling you, you need to get, you got to put your faith in God, right? In Jesus Christ. Amen. Go to 2 Corinthians 4:18. Can y'all handle that? Is that all right? You know, a lot of times, and you have to be careful why you think like that. You know, you want to put your faith all in man, because sometimes, you know, people subconsciously use that as an out. You know, because I can blame you.
Yep.
I was depending on you. Well, praise the Lord. I was depending on me too to a degree. y'all got to, amen. But come on, we need to put our faith where it needs to be, right? 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, "While we look not at the things that are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things that are seen are temporal, and the things that are not seen are eternal." In other words, faith was given to us by God so that we could deal with eternal things. So when we make a decision to use our faith, our mentality should be, we're about to reach into the realm of the eternal and bring something into this realm that will last forever, right? When we get ready to use our faith, since faith was given to us by God to deal with eternal things, our mentality should be, we are about to reach into the realm of the eternal and bring something into this realm that will last forever. You got it? And y'all receive that?
Amen.
Amen. See, that's real important, because actually, from God's perspective, healing is eternal.
Amen.
It's an eternal thing, right? Amen. When Jesus rose from the dead, and all of the death and the diseases that came upon him, all of the sicknesses that came upon him for our sakes, amen. When Jesus got healed from all of that, it was an eternal healing.
Amen.
Y'all got it? By his stripes, from his perspective now, we are eternally healed. Man, God, dog. It takes faith to grab that, but I'm trying to get you to grab it, right? Right? Y'all all right? Amen. It, by his stripes, we were eternally healed. Right? All right, let's go back to heaven, right? They got them books up there, right? With your name in them, right? And your benefits in it, right? 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 Now, by your name, as it relates to physical health, you know, out here in the ledger, by Jesus' stripes, they were healed eternally 2,000 years ago. I guarantee you, if you were allowed to look in the books, it is not in the books every 6 months. Yeah. what would you want to believe? What would you like to strive to use your faith for?
Eternal healing,
or every 6 months you going through? Now I'm listen. What if some happen? Well, forget about what if some happen. What if some don't happen? What you gonna do? What, right, right, right. If some happen, you still won't. And I'm not putting nobody down. I'm not ministering condemnation, anything of that nature. You follow me? Because, you know, listen, I have had to fight for my healing on occasions. But I fought.
Amen.
And I won.
Amen.
You understand? So I'm not ministering condemnation at all. But I'm trying to, because if you don't be careful, the enemy will put you in a mindset where your expectation will be to be sick every now and then. And I'm just telling you, that expectation is not of the Lord. That did not come from Jesus. I haven't read anywhere in Scripture. This is a faith builder, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, nobody feel bad? Nobody under condemnation? Faith builder, right? I have not read anywhere in Scripture where Jesus healed anybody. And he said, not 2 months from now, though. This same condition gonna be coming on back here now. That ain't in your Bible. That ain't about where they died, Pastor, but you ain't read nowhere where Jesus healed them. They died from a sickness. Right? When Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead and he eventually died one day, there's no scripture to say he died from an ailment. There's no scripture that says when Moses died, he died from some type of deficiency of old age or something, you know, some kind of. No, when his time was up, he went on to be with the Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord buried him. Y'all getting just what I'm saying? Amen. And so I'm trying to get you to get with me, and let's believe that we're not looking for no sickness. Okay. All right. And if somebody had to deal with somebody, what we going to do?
We're
getting together. We touching an agreement. We rebuking. We binding. We telling the devil he has no authority, no legal right to be here. Right? We casting out. We doing. Y'all got. We appropriating what our covenant has provided for us. We reaffirming what Jesus has already done. And that's what you're supposed to do. Instead of being mad with me, well, you just don't know. My nose running out. You just don't. Now, how does that sound, right? Wait, arm is not a word. I mean, arm is not it's a word, but it's, you know. I'm trying. Did I say it right? Even did I say that I am? Yeah. It's my linguist back there. I'm trying to get you to believe that you are healed. You fighting me in your mind to be sick. Now, how does that sound? It's something wrong with you. Yeah. Right, and then, go on. And then want some prayer. Well, what am I supposed to pray? Will somebody tell me? I'm believing for you to be healed. You fighting for your right to be sick. What am I supposed to pray when I pray for you then? Let the will of the Lord be done. Come on. You don't have to fight me on that. I see, and you know people know better. Because if I was praying for $50,000 to be released into your life today, you understand what I'm saying? Don't believe it to my, yeah, but yeah, Jesus became poor, that I might become rich. You know, all God's blessings are mine. Yeah. Yeah. It won't be no fight then. Use your faith, Pastor. Y'all got it? Now listen. Over the years God have had to teach me, you know, about how to deal with people, because people are on different levels with their faith. And that's why I'm always prefacing. I'm not ministering condemnation. You follow me? But I'm a purist. If you want to, you know, it means just what it said. You know, I'm a purist. You got, and so, and I used to get in trouble because I'd go places, you know, with this pure thing, man, and I'd just lay it, no out, no way out, no plan B. I wouldn't give them no plan B, no nothing. You by stripes you healed, and that's it. Yeah, we don't need to talk about nothing else. Well, the Lord had to teach me that I can't just do that. You follow me? Because everybody's still learning and growing. People coming in the body at different times. They sit up on the different types of teachings and so forth and so on. And there's a wisdom that I had to walk in, you know, as it relates to that. Y'all, I know y'all. But my point is, you know, listen, I'm not against going to the doctor. I'm so glad that we got people that work in the medical community, you know, that are saved, that are born again, man. Because they probably, a lot of folks that went home to the Lord early, if we didn't have some saints in the medical field. Y'all got it? Amen. Who was secretly praying and laying hat all on their hand when they touch people and all that stuff. Y'all got, and at their bedside, instead of talking about all these side effects that's going to kill you, you know, at their bedside saying, you know, we believe in God, you know, can I pray with you? Y'all follow me? What they're doing in the midst, oh, God, have mercy. In the midst of all of those deadly decorations, over the lives of people sometime. Amen. Somebody, God got somebody in there and say, listen, we trust in God. We believe in God. Trying to energize their faith. Y'all follow me? Because all the hope they had when they went in there is gone. Are y'all right? Because somebody got to protect themselves from a lawsuit. Okay. See, I get that. See, that kind of stuff I get in trouble about. But it's the truth anyhow, right? Amen. And so, but we're not ministering condemnation. But I am trying to, you know, build your feet, tune you on up and build your faith up a little bit higher. Is that all right? Along with myself. You know, because the scripture says while you're preaching to another man, you're preaching to yourself. While you're teaching another man, you're teaching yourself. See, so this tune up is good for me too. Is that all right? So we reach into the realm of the eternal and bring something into this realm that will last forever. The Lord said to me, the problem with his people are having is that they have been, and get this, he said, they have been believing for temporary fixes instead of eternal conclusions. He said, they have been believing for temporary fixes instead of eternal conclusions. Yeah. Y'all got it? And that's that whole mindset of every now and then. And you know we are. And who you think you are. You just wait. Your time come. The devil is a liar. He don't even control time. God controls time. Y'all getting to see what I'm saying? And so he said they've been actively believing for temporary fixes. And some of them do not want you to bother them about their temporary fixes either. Y'all got to get mad with the preacher. When the preacher starts saying, man, get rid of that temporary fix. Let's get it all. Let's be done with it. Let's. Y'all got. And then he gave me a scriptural example of that, of course, over in, you don't have to turn to Exodus 14 chapter verse 13, when the people God used Moses to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt, and y'all know the story, right? And they got to the Red Sea, and Pharaoh was coming behind, and mountains on both sides. And the Bible said they began to fear and you know, go off on Moses about he brought them out there to die in the wilderness and to be killed. Their children and their children's children, their wives are going to be prey for the enemy and all that type of thing. See, and all that was because he took away from them the thing that they were depending on. All that was because he kicked the crutch of Egypt from up. He kicked the crutch from upon them. Y'all got, and they didn't have that to walk with no more. and to depend on no more. You follow me? In other words, he was saying, I'm going to put your dependency where it's supposed to be at. It's supposed to be on God and on nobody else. Y'all got, and so when he kicked that crutch away from them, they got hot about it. They got mad about it. Yeah. And so they went to going off on the man of God. And Moses went to God, you know, and said, Lord, you know, what I'm going to do? The folk about to turn on and so forth and so on. You know, and God said, well, what's wrong with you? So he had to jack him up. Why are you crying to me? That's what he told Moses. He said, right. He said, why are you crying to me? You follow? Amen. Amen. And he told him, he said, you tell the people to move forward. He said, now you stretch forth your rod. Right? Amen. And then he said, and then Moses went back and told him, God said, move forward. And then he gave him a rhema word. He said, the enemy that you see today, you'll see no more forever. No more forever. Right. No more forever. See. In other words, he was saying this is going to be an eternal conclusion. You won't ever worry about Pharaoh no more forever. No more bricks and mortars without, no more hard labor. No more forever. And so God said the church needs to start declaring no more forever. Some eternal conclusions about things. Glory to God. I heard somebody say, I said it one time, and I heard the Lord say, I don't care. Say it again. Keep on declaring it. No more forever. No more forever, see. So that was an eternal conclusion. In Mark 11 and 21, you don't have to turn there. You know, the Bible talks about how Jesus and Peter was coming into the city, and Peter called to remember the day before Jesus cursed the fig tree. Right? He cursed the fig tree, and the next day it had withered away, the Bible said, from the root, right? Yeah. Amen. And that's when you declare no more forever, that means you're getting at the root of the thing, right? And Jesus answered and said unto him, told Peter, Peter was excited, amen, and I can't tell you, I probably would have been excited too. Yeah, y'all got it, that when, because when he came out, that thing was dead. Right? It was dead. And Jesus told Peter to have faith in God, right? To have faith in God. In other words, when Jesus cursed that tree, he declared an eternal conclusion. He said, no man eat hereafter from thee forever, right? In other words, this is over with right here. Yeah, that was an eternal conclusion. It wasn't a temporary fix. Glory to God. Dr. Thompson a few years ago came out with a phrase during his financial teaching called, he's, you know, you pull the handle, and he said, I'll never be broke. Amen. Another day. You know what he was declaring? An eternal conclusion. No more forever. Y'all got it. Like one preacher told me, money will always be around me. He said, I don't even worry about it. It's going to always be. See, it's because I said a preacher said it. Some of y'all got a problem. Y'all all right? I mean, maybe you ought to say that. Maybe you ought to look to your neighbor and say, neighbor, money will always be around me. Why are you looking for some broke days? No. Yeah. See, just because a preacher said it, though, it made something wrong with it. No. But I'll never be broke another day in my life. Money will always be around me. It is so. Glory to God. Glory to God. Yeah. Amen. Now watch it. Yeah, now watch money always be around you. And you'll never be broke another day in your life. See, that's an eternal conclusion. You're not looking for a temporary fix. You're not looking to have money this month and no money next month. That's an eternal conclusion. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Yeah. Amen. No more forever. Lord, have mercy. Now listen, go to Romans 10 and 17. I'm about to get there, y'all. Because we live by faith. Just live by his faith. Amen. And so what that means is whatever you believe in, that's the type of life it's going to produce for you. Romans 10 and 17. Y'all get anything out of this? Thank you, Jesus. All right. I'm coming. Read it. Verse 17.
So then faith cometh by hearing.
Amen. So then faith cometh by hearing, right?
And
hearing by the word of God. Amen. And so the just lives by his faith, right? And faith comes by hearing, right? And hearing by the word of God, right? And so that means that you have to hear a specific thing. You just can't hear everything. You can't listen to all that the world has to say about your living. Y'all got it? You cannot let the world determine how you gonna live by your listening to what they got to say about your life. And you'll be surprised how many people do that. They let the world tell them how they're going to live. Right? Instead of allowing the word to tell them how they're going to live. I told you you had to be bilingual. You got to be able to be in the world and out of the world. You got to be able to understand the language of the world without allowing it to become final authority in your life. Y'all got it? Now, listen, you may not have thought about it in this manner, but words are designed to be final authority. Whatever words you allow to govern your life, that's what's going to be the final authority in your life. You got it? So you can't be saying a brother can't never get a break. Because if you say a brother never can get a break, that's going to be final authority. That word is going to become law into your life. Whenever you decree a thing, it becomes established in your life. So you can't say anything. You can't embrace anything that anybody tries to say over your life. You got it? And some things you just have to really just stand against, you know, overtly. You know, I told them Tuesday I went fishing the other day and where I was fishing at on the pier, I wasn't catching anything. God came by, said they tanned them up down there. So I went down where they were, right, and got in the spot. And when I got in the spot, I immediately started catching fish, right? And there was a lady sitting next to me who was not catching any fish, right? And she didn't understand what was going on. And she started talking about, jinx, 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 jinx. I said, that won't work on me. Yeah, I said, that won't work on me. I said, what you got to do is be happy for me. If you want to catch some fish, now if you ain't going to get happy for me.
You still ain't going to catch
me. See, I was supposed to just stand there and let her declare that over. Let her declare that over my life. The devil is a lie. I said, you better get happy for me. Because that ain't going to work. It ain't good English, but that's
it.
That ain't going to work. That ain't going to work. So you have to be careful, amen, what you hear, right? You have to be careful. Have you ever noticed, too, that if you don't be careful, how the enemy will try to get you to release faith into some foolishness somebody done said about you? It's a subtle thing, but he'll try to get you to do. He'll try to get you to get in agreement with some crazy somebody done said about your life, and you have to actively and on purpose resist the devil, so he'll flee from you. Faith comes by hearing, right?
Amen.
Hearing by the word of God, right? Mark 11:22. Jesus told Peter, he said, "Have faith in God," right? So Romans 10 and 17 builds in you the capacity to believe. Right? Mark 11, 22 encourages you to make a decision to trust God based on an act of your will that will be manifested through your actions. Right? Paul said faith comes by hearing. Right? And Jesus said have faith in God. Right? In other words, you trust that God is going to bring to pass the desires of your heart. Right? And not man. James 2 and 20 said this way, but without no vain man, that faith without works is dead. Go to Hebrews 4 and 2. I want to show you something. Hebrews 4 and 2. Everybody say, he almost there. Tell him you had to get plugs. New wires, antifreeze, all that. Use some 5,000 mile. Get you off that 3,000. Get you off that 3,000 mile oil. You need some 5,000, some synthetic oil.
And come back next week.
I know that's real. Hebrews 4 and verse 1 and 2. I'm trying to turn there. Are y'all there?
Amen.
Nobody mad, huh? She said, therefore, fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it, right? For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it, right? The word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it, right? And so the word is supposed to profit you, right?
Amen.
Or it's supposed to cause you to profit. You got it? It's supposed to produce some positive results, amen, in your life, right? Now here the scripture says it's only one reason why the word didn't profit them. Right? It said it's because they did not mix faith with it. Right? One reason it said the word did not profit them, right? Because it did not. Come on, I'm not talking about you. Say amen.
Amen.
Because they did not do what? Because they did not mix faith with it. Amen. And so you may have known this, but I want to tie some things, some strings together for you. Amen. I want to talk to you about the mixing process. All right? Because I need the word to profit. For me, cause me to profit, right? So I need to understand the mixing process if it's going to produce profit, right? Go to Romans 10 and 8. You ever wonder about that? How to mix? All these scholars in here, they ain't wonder about that. They already know how to do that. How to mix faith with the word. Romans 10 and 8, right?
Amen.
So you got to do something with the word you hear, right?
Amen.
You got to mix faith with it, right? Okay. Now, the capacity for faith has already been built in you because it comes when you hear the word, right?
Amen.
Then you have to turn around and take that faith and mix it with that same word. That's an amazing dichotomy, isn't it? The word brings faith, and once faith is birthed in you, you have to mix it with the word. Right? Romans 10 and 8 says, but what saith it, the word is nigh thee, right? Even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved, right? For with the heart man is believed unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture said, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew or the Greek, and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not heard, believe? And how shall they believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Amen. Understanding the mixing process. In those particular passages of scripture, you'll find a mixing process. And the mixing process is this. You got to hear it. You got to believe it. You got to confess it. And you got to act on the word that you heard. Did y'all get that? I know it, Pastor. Okay, we'll see. You got to hear it. Say it.
Hear it.
I got to believe it.
I
got to confess it. And I got to act on it. That's the mixing process. All right. In verse 13 and 14 of that same chapter, just read it, it says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Verse 14 says, how then shall they what? Call on him in whom they have not believed, right? And how shall they believe in him in whom of whom they have not heard, right? And how shall they do what?
Hear.
How shall they hear without what?
Without
a preacher. Amen. So you got to hear it from a believing preacher who has been sent by God. Right? You got to hear it. You got to believe it. You got to confess it. And you got to act on it. Right? And you got to hear that from a believing preacher who has been sent from God. See, what I've been teaching y'all today, all preachers don't believe it. There are some preachers that don't believe in healing. There are some preachers that don't believe, only thing they believe about prosperity is that it's for them. There's some people that believe, preachers that believe, everybody ain't going to be rich, but they going to be rich. Y'all got it? So you got to hear this stuff from a preacher that believes it. Y'all got it? Because we're talking about the mixing process now, right? So you got to hear it from a believing preacher, right? And then you got to believe it based on the act of your will. Go to St. John 20 and 19. We mixing now, right? Got to find me a believing preacher. You just can't go to any church. Yeah, I sure said it. You just can't go to any church. You have to make sure that the preacher is a believer. What you think you're going to get from a preacher that believes in poverty? That believe everybody ain't going to be rich, and he can't tell you what not you one of the everybody's. The devil is a lie. Y'all got it? So you need to hear that from a preacher that believes. I believe every last one of the members that belongs to Rightly Dividing the Word Church of God supposed to be rich.
Amen.
Every last one of them. Y'all got, I'm not believing for any of them to be broke. Another day in their life. I'm not believing for any of them to be sick. Another day. Now, if you want somebody else, another preacher that believe that for you, you need to go and find him, because I'm not believing for you to get sick another day in your life. I'm not believing for you to be poor another day in your life. You're not going to get me to change what I believe about that. I'm not going to do it. Y'all got it? Amen. Now, you know, and if you want to go on somewhere and get in agreement with somebody who do believe you're supposed to be sick and you're supposed to be broke and all that, you know, I love you. But I'm not going there for you. Y'all got it? Amen. Amen. That's what you want, right? You don't want me to be believing for you to get sick, right? Or somebody else. Y'all can believe for anybody else on your road but you. And it's not a put down. Not a put down. You got it? Amen. So somebody called me this morning. You know, I prayed for them. Plead God for them. That's what you're supposed to do.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. That's what you're supposed to do. So we got to hear it from a believing preacher, right?
Amen.
Right? We talking about how to mix it, right? Then you got to believe it based on an act of will. St. John 20 and 19. Are you there?
Amen.
Lord, let me see. Can I read fast? Then the same day, even being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you, right? He wanted them to be at peace, right? And when he had said so, he answered unto them, he showed unto them his hands and his side, right? Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus to them, again, peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, oh God, have mercy. You know, if God wanted, because I still feel somebody, if God wanted his disciples to tell the folk that it was all right for them to be sick, why would he tell them, when you go, preach the gospel, right? Lay hands on the sick. Y'all got cast out devils. Baptize them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Why would he go and tell them to lay hands on the sick if that was his will for the sick to stay sick? Wasn't his will? Now put that in your pipe and smoke it. Get you a contact. Woo! We going there, y'all, because here in the last few days and months, you know, God been really dealing with me about this healing thing now. He been dealing with me about this healing thing. Y'all got it. And just about, you know, a lot of things we're going to do, most of it going to be around healing. You know, he been dealing, he said, especially when you go, I want you praying for the sick. You know, I want you to have several meetings a year where healing is a topic. And we gonna operate in this word where healing is concerned, because God want his folks well. He want them well. He want them whole.
Hallelujah.
I'm just telling y'all that it ain't the will of God. Y'all ain't mad, are you? Glory to God. Well, my thank you. You said 22. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord, right? Believing preachers. But he said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my fingers into the prints of the nails, that thrust my hands into his side, I will do what? He ain't mixing no faith in nothing he heard. He said, I will not believe, right? So believing is an act of the will. You got it. Y'all know the story. Jesus came, amen, a day or so later, amen, and he seen Thomas, and Thomas, he told him to look here, my hands, and the holes in my feet and in my side. And the Bible said Thomas fell down and said, my Lord and my God. And Jesus basically rebuked him. He said, Thomas, thou believe because thou hast seen. Right? And he said, but blessed are those, empowered to prosper, are those who believe and have not seen. Those are the ones that understand how to mix faith with what they have heard. Oh, y'all hear what I'm saying? So you need a believing preacher, right?
Amen.
Amen. You need to believe yourself based on an act of your will, right? And go to Romans, back to Romans 10 and 8. Then you got to confess it. I got to hear it. I got to believe it. And then I got to confess it. Y'all getting tired? Romans 10 and 8. Blame it on them folks that they passed, they all changed. They they got to get greased. Romans 10 and 8. They need tires and everything. Y'all got Romans 10 and 8? Said, but what saith the word is not even in thy where?
Mouth.
Even in thy where?
Mouth.
It's in thy mouth, right? Now, what do you use your mouth for? You got to say something. You got to say something with that word. You can't just be in your heart. And don't come out your mouth. You're going to have to. That's how I know what's in your heart. You know, what come out of your mouth. I can tell what I'm dealing with a believer or not. All I got to do is listen to what. Y'all got it? He said, that word is not even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt do what?
Confess.
With thy mouth, right? I'm showing you how to mix now. You got to hear from a believing preacher.
Yeah, that's it.
You got to make a decision to believe, amen, by an act of your will, right?
Amen.
And then you got to confess it with your mouth. Confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead. Thou shalt do what?
Be
saved. For with the heart man believeth unto what?
Righteousness.
And with the mouth what?
Confession
is made unto salvation. Your deliverance is going to be enacted based on your confessing it with your mouth.
Right.
You got to say it.
Amen.
We rebuke hurricane season, didn't we?
Amen.
They about out of here. They out of here. They season about to come to an end. They ain't had nothing to celebrate.
Hallelujah.
You understand? Right. You can't tell me that ain't under God. Answering the prayers of believers. People who are confessing. Y'all, you know that's God. Lord, help me, Jesus. You know, our area, I don't know what y'all know it or not, they send meteorologists into this area, the southern region of the United States, especially from the Texas coast all the way down to the Florida coast for their training. Yeah, that's why they come. And if you notice, except for those that live here, most of them, especially on a certain channel, they send them in here and they stay about 5 or 6 years and get their hurricane training. And after you know, they enhance their resume package, right? And then they ship them on out of here, right? And so we just messing them all up now because they got a new one in, town now. And I know he in him for some training. I just know he in. And he ain't getting no training.
No.
You got it? And the man was, the anchor said, well, man, it looks good. The Caribbean is quiet down there. And he said, not yet. You know, he mad because he ain't got no hurricane. Yeah, he need to enhance his resume. He need to be able to say he was down in Mobile, Alabama, and he go because of some company. He got to get out there with his raincoat on, and he got to be out there in it. You see, he want to be Jim Cantrell Jr., you know. He got to be out there in the devil like you ain't getting no training. You might well move, brother, because we ain't having it. We ain't having it. He told me, not yet. It ain't over yet. And pointed at the man. I said, he mad. Because ain't nothing brewing in the Caribbean. The devil is. So you got to confess with your mouth, right? Man, you got to speak the word only. Right? 2 Corinthians 4:13 said, therefore we believe, therefore we speak. Right? Listen, Mark 5:22, I'm closing. They back there gone. I upset them almost back there in the booth. People jumping up. Sign language in me. I must have called somebody's name. If I want to get princess jumping, just call somebody's name. She's trying to keep me from a lawsuit. If I call her name, I'm in trouble, y'all. She
what?
Mark 5. I'm closing. She a good editor, though.
Amen.
with that live streaming on. Mark 5, 22. I'm good. I didn't call it the news station call signs. And everybody know Canturi. He the Grim Reaper. He mean reap on way me. He ain't getting that now. Yeah. Mark 5 and 20. Y'all there? Make it 21. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea, and behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, right? Jairus, by name, right? And when he saw him, he fell at his feet, and brought him, and besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she live, right? And Jesus went with him, and so that means he consented to do it, right? He went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years, right, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, was and nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Jesus, right, and I'd like to submit to you that she heard about Jesus from some believers. I choose to believe it was some preachers, Sister Coleman, but whoever she heard it from, it was from some believers, right? She heard about Jesus, amen, from some believers, right? Amen. What verse? 27. And when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind, right, and touched his garment. For she said, if I may what? Right. She didn't, listen, did you know that the Bible didn't say she thought it in her mind? Right. Y'all got it. She didn't have nobody else to preach to, so she preached to herself. Glory to God. Are y'all all right? She said, if I can but touch, that's what she said, his garment, I will what?
Behold.
I will be whole. For she said, I shall touch his garment. But his clothes I shall behold. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague, right? And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that somebody had mixed faith with what they had heard. Y'all got it? Because she heard it from a believer. She believed it herself. Are y'all all right? She confessed it out of her mouth, and then she acted on what she heard. She said, I got to go find this man. I'm not wait to see whether or not he's coming down my street. I'm going to find him. She acted on that word that she heard. She mixed that faith that came with that word that she heard. Y'all got it? She touched him. And he looked around about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. Isn't it amazing? In her condition, glory to God, she didn't fear while she was trying to get to Jesus. Whoa, I'm trying to tell y'all right now, y'all, faith took all of the fear out of her while she was trying to get to Jesus. And I'm trying to tell you, when you're trying to get to Jesus, you have to remove, God have not given me the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Y'all got, and she, in that pure faith, touched the hem of Jesus' garment without fear and got what she believed. Y'all got, she received what she was looking for. And then after she got healed, did y'all notice that even though fear came, it didn't take away her healing? Did y'all hear me? Fear came afterward, but her healing stayed intact. Eternal conclusion. One pastor scripture says, and she got restored everything. She got made whole. And what that means, not just her physical body, but her, she got her money back. She got her reputation back. She probably became an evangelist, you know. Come see this woman that was sick for 12 years with an issue of blood. Can't you see that woman going to church? Anybody in here got an issue? Oh, yeah, anybody in here got an issue? The same Jesus said that we can lay hands on the sick and they will recover. You know that thing was running around laying hands on everything she can find. Be healed in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Be healed. Now listen, virtue went out of Jesus, but now virtue was going out of her.
All right.
Y'all hear what I'm saying? Listen, she mixed that thing. Y'all got it? I'm through with verse. He said unto her, daughter, thy faith have made thee what?
Whole.
Faith in the word that she heard. Faith in the confession of her mouth. Faith in her ability to act on what she believed. And you know what? Listen. It's what you do is what count with God. That woman had to drag herself to Jesus. Y'all, you know, she wasn't even supposed to be out during the day. Because according to the law, she had been out among us regular folks. Y'all got it. And she was unclean. Y'all, she hadn't been out there. And she's supposed to be screaming, unclean, 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 so that they could know who to throw the rocks at and keep. Y'all hear what I'm saying? My point is, sometimes people be thinking, well, I ain't got nothing enough to act on. Yes, you do. You got something. You got to be corresponding actions with what you say you believe. She drug her way to Jesus. She pressed her way to Jesus. She done whatever she had to do to touch him. 35, while he yet spake, that came from the ruler of the synagogue house, certain which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troubleth the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid. He that will come shall come. And he will not tarry. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? See, this man had got a word from Jesus. He got a word from Jesus. That Jesus said, I'm going to come and I'm going to heal your daughter. And you know, when you get a word from Jesus, it does not matter what happens in between what he said he was going to do, when he said he was going to do. It does not matter what happens in between those two periods of time. So long as you can find out a place where he said it. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? He had got a word.
Amen.
You know, it make me wonder. Oh, that's too much. Make me wonder sometime. Whether or not people are actually standing on the word. What or not the word? Y'all, because I questioned the Lord about that. I said, now, Lord, wait a minute now. Wait a minute. This girl passed. This girl passed. He said she may have passed, but he had a word before she passed. And he would, the just shall live by his. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? And he would not, when Jesus reaffirmed what he said he's going to do, he would not turn or loose that word. Do y'all hear me? And even though the baby died, glory to God, he still had a word from the Lord. See, a lot of people want to call the Lord a lie. You know, when stuff don't happen the way they want it to happen. And I beg to go you one different. It ain't that the Lord lied. That too much? That's too heavy. I said it's not that the Lord lied. Because he's not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he has to repent. It's not God. Now that's big boy and big girl stuff right there. For all of us, from the pulpit to the door, he never lies. You got, I'm telling you, all that's within you, you hold on to what that word said. You hold on to what the word of the Lord is unto you. And somebody said, how long? As long as it takes. You still got breath in your body. You hang right on. You know, Hebrews 10 and 35 said, cast not away therefore your confidence, which have great recompense of reward. Because he that said he was coming, he coming. I said he coming. Pastor, what if you die? Well, die in the faith. Die, but if you're going to die, die believing. Did y'all hear? And this is just what I believe, too. Now, if you die believing, your reward on the other side going to be greater than what you were believing for on this side. When you get on the other side, it ain't going to even, it ain't. I'm not telling nobody to die. I'm just saying, if you die, die believing. Die in faith. Die trusting God. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? And there's got to be a greater reward on the other side of that kind of death. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? The just shall live by his faith. Don't let the devil minister no condemnation to you, no fear to you. You follow me? You know, I'm not attacking where you are right now. I'm just trying to show you where we all need to be. You got it? Amen. And somebody got it. The Bible said we're supposed to strive for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. And that's the kind of faith they operated in. Abraham didn't even have the Holy Ghost. Y'all, he didn't even have y'all got it. And the Bible said he was the father of the faith, father of us all as it relates to faith. Man, he bleed through death. Put that ball on that altar. Tied him up. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Y'all all right? Amen. And he wouldn't change what God said, that ball was going to be his heir. Y'all got, and he got a rhema word. He said, well, if God's going to have to raise him from the dead, he told me he was going to be his heir, my heir, and then he told me to kill him. He said, if I kill him, he's going to have to raise him from the dead because he cannot tell a lie. He can't, he cannot tell a lie. You know, he's going to have to do both of these things. I'm going to have to kill him and he's going to have to raise him from the dead, but God cannot lie. Y'all all right? Praise God. That capacity is within you. The same spirit that was in Jesus is in us. Amen. Faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the word. Amen. You know, you can't have that kind of faith if nobody teach like that. You got to teach like that. You got to teach like that. You've been there before anyhow. You got, you know, I'm...